A lot of people are interested in the speech of the new Pope, perhaps especially as he has a localizable accent. That is, he doesn't just speak general American. In fact, the Pope's speech gives us an opportunity to explore not just his regional accent, but the fascinating topic of vowel shifts. And we'll find that things may not be quite how we're led to believe. Jeff Lindsay. The Pope, born Robert Prevost.
I'm Bishop Robert Prevost. Robert Prevost.
Is, like both his parents, a native of Chicago, Illinois, and he grew up in or adjacent to Chicago's South Side, in neighborhoods that were certainly not super affluent.
He's a regular guy.
Linguistically, Chicago is in America's inland north. It's the biggest and most populous of a group of cities, others include Detroit, Michigan, Cleveland, Ohio, and Rochester in New York State, which are famous for something linguists call a chain shift, specifically the northern cities' vowel shift, or just the northern cities' shift. So what is a chain shift? Well, chains are made of interconnected links, and here the links are vowel sounds. If a chain moves, like on a bicycle, then so do all the links. The basic idea, then, is that if there's a change in the pronunciation of one vowel in an accent, then neighbouring vowels are liable to change as well, and in the same direction. So what do I mean by neighbouring, and what do I mean by direction? Well, vowels are points or areas in a continuous space. The analogy I often make is with colours. In fact, I made a whole video going into that in some detail. We can refer to individual colours like red and blue, but we all know that colours don't have clear boundaries. You can actually slide from one to another in a colour space. It's the same with vowels. People often think of the space as being inside your mouth, but more fundamentally, vowels, like colours, are perceptual objects, and we can plot them in a very roughly triangular auditory space. The difference between these kinds of space, though, needn't concern us here. The standard story of the northern cities' shift goes like this. If we take as our reference these general American vowels, which we can represent by phonetic symbols or by keywords that contain them, then in the northern cities they can be described as all being shifted in a clockwise direction. So the keywords are now all associated with different phonetic symbols. Shifts certainly don't have to be clockwise. In my book English After RP, I described the large-scale anti-clockwise shift that distinguishes modern SSB from old RP. This is all very abstract, so let's listen to some concrete examples. The most easily noticeable links in the inner city chain are the vowels of trap and lot. In Chicago and the other northern cities, the trap vowel is raised and can be diphthongized, air. Here's a famous Chicagoan, the long-serving former mayor, Richard Daley.
When we fall short, as we sometimes have, to tackle the most serious challenges,
And here is the Pope, speaking several years ago.
What it means to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. The kind of attitudes that can fool people.
Now the lot vowel is fronted to something like ah, lat.
Still humbled by the opportunity. I am very confident.
Doctrine hasn't changed. Not profound.
So how and when do shifts like these happen? Typically, one vowel changes first, then neighbouring vowels start to do the same. Linguists call it a push chain if a shifting vowel pushes the one ahead of it, and a drag chain if the shifting vowel drags the one behind it. We all experience drag chains whenever we're in a slow-moving queue. To maintain intelligibility, vowels need to be kept far enough apart to be perceptually distinct from each other. So it's like a queue with social distancing. When shifts happened in the past, it may not be clear which vowel moved first and whether pushing or pulling was involved. In the northern cities, many say that trap changed first and dragged lot after it. But some others think lot moved first and trap was pushed. Now, it seems to me that the lot vowel is pretty consistently fronted by speakers in the inland north, just as the standard description says, and Mayor Daly seems to be pretty much as consistent with the raised trap vowel. But listen to the Pope here.
They say when they clap at the beginning, it doesn't matter much. Clap.
So the stressed vowel in the word matter is clearly shifted, but the vowel of clap, not so much. Now, if a vowel shifts, you might expect it to shift in all the words that contain it, but this is not always the case. For example, part of the southern British anti-clockwise shift was so-called goose fronting, so that RP goose became SSB goose. But before a final L, goose didn't front, and the old quality survived, so this word didn't change to ghoul, but remained pretty much unchanged, ghoul. Now, I certainly haven't done a comprehensive and exhaustive study of the Pope's speech, but this difference in his shifting of the trap vowel may be because of the phonetic context, possibly the following P in clap. And we'll be finding a lot more examples of these shifts being not quite as simple as they're sometimes described. Let's look at another link in the chain, namely the thought vowel, which is said to be dragged down by lot into a fairly open quality.
You still want to applaud? Applaud.
Which is a good moment to point out that the Pope does have a thought vowel distinct from his lot vowel. In other words, he doesn't have the cot-court merger or lot-thought merger, which has happened for most North Americans. In a recent video, I announced our big survey on North American pronunciation, which has already had over 10,000 responses. You can still take it if you haven't already. As you see, practically 70% of our respondents say they pronounce cot and court the same. And this map from our results shows that the majority of the millions of speakers who still do pronounce them differently are in the northeastern part of the USA, including a majority, though not an overwhelming majority, of respondents in the Chicago area. The Chicago respondents who have the merger may have come from elsewhere, or may reflect the inexorable creep of the merger that's been reported for the inland north. Now, if the northern city's thought vowel doesn't catch the ear quite as distinctively as the shifted cat and cat vowels, this wouldn't be surprising given that the lowering of the thought vowel will make it more similar to the merged cot-court vowel of so many North Americans, and unlike the classic New York variety, as in thought and coffee. However, Mayor Daly's thought vowel is not the one in the standard descriptions of the northern city's shift. It's rounded, diphthongal, and not that low. In other words, not so different from the New York variety.
The nation's recession has meant job loss. Job loss. Job loss.
And the Pope can sound quite similar.
People have gone looking for God. 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 God.
This is also a good point to mention this interesting pair of words. Among Americans who do distinguish cot and court, some pronounce on with the lot vowel and others pronounce it with the thought vowel. Linguists sometimes talk of the on line, north of which you tend to get on and south of which you tend to get on. This map from our survey shows that Chicago is to the north of the line.
And on that level,
Now, the city's name was traditionally pronounced with the thought vowel in its stressed syllable.
Chicago. Chicago.
But this has been decreasing for some time, even with speakers who still have strongly shifted vowels.
I'm from Chicago.
Chicago.
On Reddit, I found most Southsiders reporting that they say Chicago, but a few saying that they have Chicago. Now, there are three more vowels involved in the northern city's shift: dress, strut, and also kit. First, dress, which is pushed from below by trap. Now, dress has two options here. It could follow the New Zealand pattern and also move upwards, so trip and dress. I made a video about New Zealand vowels, at least the short ones. But in the northern cities, instead of raising, dress sidesteps and centralises, being pronounced more like the general American strut vowel, which I devoted a whole video to. By the way, corroborating what I said in that video, the overwhelming majority of our survey respondents said that above has the same vowel in both syllables. But here things start getting messy. Remember Pope Leo not raising the trap vowel in clap? Well, the Chicago dress vowel certainly doesn't seem to be an across-the-board phenomenon. In the speech of both the Pope and Mayor Daley, it very often has a general American quality.
We have made Chicago a better place.
Pope Benedict.
Test scores of many students.
To in some way be led.
The place where the dress vowel is clearly centralized is before L.
As we celebrate this morning.
There's been a development.
Or their health insurance.
God who dwells.
The bishop himself.
I don't have many examples of clearly centralized dress other than before L.
Especially.
Also, we can occasionally hear another variety of the shifted dress vowel, like ah. In other words, it seems to have swapped places with trap.
And do more with less.
Things are similarly messy with the kit vowel, which I didn't mention before as it's kind of outside the main chain. Like dress, according to the standard story, kit centralises, dragged in the wake of dress, and or pushed out of the way by extreme raising of trap. But as with dress, most of the time in the speech of Mayor Daley and the Pope, it sounds pretty general American to me.
What faith should be about is
income tax credit.
Myths.
We're helping the hardest hit workers.
As with dress, the main place where kit centralizes is adjacent to L.
That mystery, if you will. The church lived.
But it's probably the strut vowel, at least as far as I can hear, that diverges most from the standard story of the northern city's shift. According to the story, strut moves into the place previously occupied by thought, becoming a mid, back, rounded vowel. Supposedly, bus is pronounced like a northeastern general American boss. Now, I'm not the only person having difficulty finding audio examples of this. This is the best one I could find.
$1.8 billion in public investments.
What we can find are examples of strut words being pronounced with a remarkably back and or low quality, but not rounded.
God who does dwell within us.
And manage government prudently.
Though, as with dress and kit, there are lots of unshifted strut words.
Very much.
Or shut down altogether.
Interestingly, this means that shifted dress and unshifted strut can be more or less identical. In these examples of the Pope's speech, the word us and the first syllable of the word celebrate are practically mirror images.
Not just with me, but with all of us. As we celebrate this morning.
So if us has the same vowel as the first syllable of celebrate, what phoneme is it? Is it the dress phoneme or the strut phoneme? Well, this is a theoretical problem called biuniqueness, which is beyond the scope of this video. But I have to say, this kind of overlap is not really what chain shifts are classically about. I've listened to a number of speakers described online as having great Chicago accents, and the effects of the northern city shift are nowhere near as consistent as the southern British anti-clockwise shift. Good luck finding a southern Brit who still says dress, trap, and goose. I'll end by discussing some other Chicago vowels that aren't included in the standard northern city shift story, but which I think can be related to it. First, the price and mouth diphthongs. Price, like lot, is fronted to I, another clockwise shift.
The worst economic recession in modern times.
On the other hand, mouth goes against the current and backs ow, presumably to maximize the differentness of these two diphthongs.
We're laying the foundation for the future.
There have been things about visits to dioceses.
Now compare that with the southern British shift, which went the other way, anticlockwise. There, the behaviour of price and mouth was the exact converse. Price went back from RPI to SSBI, and mouth went against the current, fronting from RPOW to SSBOW. And lastly, goat and goose. In southern Britain, along with the overall anti-clockwise shift, these fronted and became more diphthongal, changing from old RP O and O to SSB O and O. And when we listen to the Pope, surprise, surprise, it's the opposite. Compared with modern General American, his goat and goose are both distinctively back and relatively monophthongal.
Including obedience, you know. No, no.
This is the way to go. Go, go.
The need for the church to announce the good news. News.
Of course, they weren't backed historically. In fact, they're conservative. But their remaining back relative to General American is consistent with the overall layout of the northern cities system.
We do believe.
If you'd like to discuss this and other topics with like-minded folks, please feel free to join my Discord, the link's below.